Welcome, Post Chapel, to our seventh week of virtual services. And believe it or not, it is the last Sunday of April already. And because it's our last week of April, we actually have a special part of our service. The last Sunday, we always have a guest speaker. And so today we have Chaplain Jeff Tilden coming to bring the word. He's one of our USCC chaplains. And so you're in for a special treat today. But why don't we get started this morning in prayer? Our God, we bless you, because you have led us to faith in you as our Father. Please live in us and move us. Breathe life into our prayers. Inhabit our praises. Speak through our words. Move through our actions for others. Live through us and help us to grow in you. Help us because our faith is weak and wavering, groveling in the dust. Lord, fan our faith into a glowing flame. Awaken our faith and trust in you until all of heaven fills our souls and all impurity and doubt has been cast out of us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, as we prepare for worship, as Peter and Virginia are going to come lead us in song, I invite you to join us with the call to worship and let the words inspire you to song as I read from Psalm 46 this morning. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we fear not, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Thank you.
time of worship, I invite you to consider giving to the Lord and giving to the chapel as God puts it on your heart to give.
So a young man was climbing Mount Everest, the highest mountain on earth, and in the face of perilous conditions, including freezing temperatures, altitude sickness, nasty wind, all those things, everything was going well for the 24-year-old. He stood 300 yards from the summit. It was in his sights, and all the glory, the accolades, and the praise and pride of conquering this massive beast was on the cusp of his fingertips. However, with just a football field in length to go, something made the young man stop. And not only did he stop, this encounter made him turn around and go back down the mountain without ever reaching the summit. Now, this is the part where I'm going to tell you that I will share the rest of the story, but you have to listen to everything else I'm going to say first. I want us to wrap our heads around a scripture that I believe is very fitting for our day. This is a scripture that reveals to us the truth that God can equip us to transverse through some of the most challenging courses. We're going to look at a passage of scripture that some of you aren't very familiar with. It comes out of the book of Habakkuk. And for some of you, you might be saying, I've heard of Habakkuk, but I might have to go to the table of contents in order to find Habakkuk. And that's okay. So we're going to look at Habakkuk chapter 3, and we're going to look at sure-footedness. Now, to be a successful mountain climber, sure-footing helps. Of course, navigation skills are important, and having the right equipment is very key. Having sheer determination to get to the top also plays a major role, but having that sure-footedness, it's what allows the climber the confidence to reach some of the most amazing heights in the midst of some of the most treacherous conditions. We may see a successful climb as reaching the summit. That's a sign of our sure footing. However, reaching the summit is not always the most important task, and that's what I want us to get today. Many times our sure footing is needed in other ways. Perhaps it's needed in ways that accomplish something much greater along the journey. Perhaps to engage an event that arises that helps tell an even better story, a story that gives people hope or that inspires them. And that's the big picture that I want us to see today. In the midst of life's journey and climb, we're going to face harsh and difficult circumstances. And it's not about removing ourselves from those circumstances, but it's about trusting in something much bigger than ourselves and realizing that we serve a God who equips us to be able to reach the heights that we do. And not only does he equip us to reach those heights, but he has a mission for us along the journey. And when we do that, we begin to operate with a joy and a confidence and a peace in the midst of uncertain and challenging circumstances. Kind of like what we're going through right now. It's very uncertain, everything that's going on. But we do serve a God who allows us to navigate these circumstances and navigate it joyfully and navigating it with confidence. In the Old Testament book of Habakkuk, we read something in the prophet's prayer that serves as an incredible reminder that one should trust in God and how in that trust comes confidence, joy, and peace in the midst of difficult times. I want to read from Habakkuk 3, verses 17 through 19, says this: though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. Habakkuk was ready for destruction to come to his people. Through a conversation that he had with God, he knew that his nation, Judah, awaited destruction at the hands of the Babylonians. And at first, Habakkuk complained to God. He wondered why God would allow a very wicked nation in Babylon, a more wicked nation, to destroy his nation. Why would God do it that way? Why would he allow evil to rid the Judeans of evil? And to think about how ridiculous it was for Habakkuk to question God's plan, I want us to think about how we may actually do the same thing, but how we also might do this in many aspects in life. Imagine getting on a commercial airplane and trying to tell the pilot how to do his job, how to fly the plane. I know I couldn't do it. Imagine going courtside to an NBA game as a fan and trying to tell LeBron James how to hit the perfect jump shot. Or imagine a civilian who's never strapped on a pair of army boots trying to lead an infantry platoon in combat. Just can't happen. We need those people who are experts to do their job and to do it well. But even more so, trying to tell God how to do his job is just something that we shouldn't do, but yet we do it all the time. When life gets hard, we pray to God and we tell him exactly how to fix it. Of course, God hardly answers our prayers exactly the way that we picture them to be answered, but that's okay. God hears our prayers. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Our role is not to tell God how to answer prayers, but it is to simply pray and trust that he has the answers. God wants us to have a joy. He wants us to have a peace, and he offers us a sure-footedness that only comes by his strength. Now, through this sure-footedness, we can navigate hazards, and we can get over those obstacles that are difficult to traverse. And through this, we can have a great confidence, and we can lead others to the same place that comes in trusting in God. So often, though, we become victims of our circumstances. We allow the circumstances to determine our joy. Now, it's no secret that army life is tough. Like Mount Everest, climbing through life on the battlefield can be grueling. And it's easy to become like Habakkuk was in the beginning of his book. We complain to God because of all the hardships that we have to endure. And in the military, there are some hardships. Spending months away from the family that you love, dealing with the strain that a separation can put on a family, on a marriage. Seeing some of the great men and women that you know lose their life fighting for this country. They're all things that are not easy to handle, and we can parallel those things to the imagery that Habakkuk uses when he talks about the trees and the vine producing no food, or the stalls in the field containing no livestock. Habakkuk is describing desperate and hopeless circumstances. Many of the circumstances you may have faced in your life may have felt desperate and hopeless. Maybe you're feeling that way now. But the great truth is that you can overcome those circumstances and you can find joy in God. You see, Habakkuk wanted to tell God how to do his job and how to fix everything, but at the end of his book, Habakkuk actually changes his tune. He is actually going back to being a man of faith, believing in something much bigger than himself. He's remembering that he can trust in God. He's remembering that his strength comes from God. Habakkuk is realizing that even in the midst of suffering and loss, that God is worth trusting, that God has a plan. The same God that Habakkuk turned to for salvation is the same God who carries his current faith. And this trust should not stop or waver back and forth. And when we have that trust and we have that joy, and we don't have our faith wrapped up in our circumstances, but have it in God, we're able to have the sure-footedness that God desires for us. Now, when I break down this prayer of Habakkuk, and I encourage you to do so, 17 through 19 of chapter 3 of Habakkuk are incredible verses. They're the last three verses in the book. But when we break it down, we're reminded of why we can trust God, why we have that sure-footedness, why we can have joy in the midst of difficult circumstances. One, I would say, in spite of despair, we can rejoice. Verse 17 of chapter 3, Habakkuk quotes this list of all these material disasters that are to come, and it's unclear how food is going to be available to eat. However, even in the midst of suffering and loss, Habakkuk is reminding that we can trust in God. Another reminder is our salvation brings us back to joy. And I think about this all the time, especially when you read David, who went through a lot in his lifetime, and he prayed to God, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." Habakkuk, in a way, is getting back to the joy of his salvation. To know God and to be one of His is to know salvation. And the beauty that we ultimately find rest, security, and comfort in His arms. And through Jesus only, you can have this salvation. And without it, it's going to be impossible to find this true joy and possible to have the confidence and the peace that Habakkuk is talking about here. But with it, we can always be brought back to joy. And we can have the strength, the sure-footedness that God offers in that salvation. It's also a reminder that God is sovereign. Habakkuk refers to God as the Lord, Yahweh. And this is a significant detail, that Yahweh is the Lord. He is sovereign. He is the one that is in control. He is the one that is above all. He is the one whose will cannot be thwarted. It's also a reminder that God is our strength. God alone has become Habakkuk's strength. And earlier in the book, we see Habakkuk complaining to God, and he's calling upon God to end the violence, the fighting, to right the wrongs. But now he's realizing, I just need to have faith. God is my strength. And also, it's a reminder that God equips the believer. He gives us the sure-footedness. So with all that said, my encouragement to you is take joy in the God of our salvation. Through His Son, Jesus Christ, God has provided us the way to Him, the way of salvation. And part of the encouragement today is to remember the salvation that comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. But it's also to help lead others to this joy of salvation as you tread along this journey. Now I'm going to finish the rest of that story. Nadab ben Yehuda was to become the youngest Israeli to reach the summit of Mount Everest at 24 years of age. However, with the top clearly in his sights, he stopped. He saw a man lying unconscious in the snow, and he decided to pass up on his chance of reaching the top to save the man's life. Yehuda picked up the injured climber, and he got a good grip on him, and he carried him all the way back down the mountain to safety, over 8 hours. In the process, Yehuda had to strip off his gloves to get a better grip on the man, and because of that, he got frostbite on his fingers. Due to his heroics, Yehuda received Israel's Presidential Medal of Honor. But I think more than awards or accolades, it's important to see this story for the amazing principles that are in it. It's easy to see it as almost a modern-day Good Samaritan parable, especially given the fact that the injured climber was Turkish and there remains a strained relationship between the countries of Israel and Turkey. Now, as a soldier in the United States Army, nothing that we do is in vain. In fact, we're in the very business of being a lifesaver. We understand part of the principle of that story because in our soldier's creed, we say we will never leave a fallen comrade. And that's the picture that I want us to get, is that God sometimes has us navigate difficult circumstances, not so that we can get to the summit and get all the glory and get to the top and say, look how accomplished I am. But sometimes He has us navigate some treacherous conditions, some huge obstacles, so that we can point others to Him along the way. You know, in the Army, we have a chance to be literal lifesavers. As Christians, we have the opportunity to lead people to the life-saving faith in Jesus Christ. So realize the strength that God gives you. Realize the heights that God equips you to climb. And realize the people that God wants you to help save along that climb and lead to Jesus. Joyfully be the light and pursue His Son Jesus. God will help navigate us to the heights.
The benediction today comes from 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 to 7. So receive the benediction today. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. God bless you this week.